I understand you're now the co-chair of the Senate Cultural Caucus.
Yes.
As of last week.
Fantastic.
Absolutely.
Fantastic news.
Thank you.
Great.
Oh, thank you. Does Damian, would you like a glass of water over near you?
I was going to pour you one.
Sure, that'd be great.
Would you like some water in addition to your tea?
Sure, but if it's room temperature. Yeah, get Damian some there. He may...
Thanks, man.
You're welcome.
Front row.
Okay, welcome, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. My name is Damian Woetzel. I am the director of the Aspen Institute Arts Program, among other artistic ventures. I'm a former dancer with the New York City Ballet, and my world has been all about the arts, and now it overlaps very distinctly with society through my Aspen program and through my other work. So this is a conversation that I'm obviously passionate about, and I'm very gratified to see this full room here of people who are similarly passionate. Many of whom have worked on various aspects of the relationship of arts and government, and many of whom just are simply believers in the importance. And it is a particular moment for this conversation. I would say, by way of preamble, we planned this much earlier, back in September, and the conversation as such, as many conversations, is somewhat different than we imagined. But by the same token, we can think about this framework as one of belief, and this is an ongoing conversation for well over 50 years in terms of the specifics of how arts and government intersect as far as funding and a commitment level, but it's also a conversation that's been going on since the founding of the United States about the relative value and what we invest in as a country. So when I think about that, I think about our audience, first of all, as one does when one is a performer. And so I thought I'd get something out of the way. Is there anyone here who does not believe that the arts have a role in society that governments should support? Okay.
Don't be shy.
So, but I would secondarily ask, how many of you think that the messaging of why the arts are important for government to have a stake in is completely clear and is working? Okay, so now we have two choruses. Mm-hmm. But I imagine that each of you have a take on it in some way. So I hope we explore those takes today, and very specifically in the work that's going on right now and the work that has led to this moment, so we can actually start to identify those reasons. I would hearken back to the founding of the National Endowment for the Arts, which was, the first step was creating the National Council. And in debate about that, it was a sense of the JFK words about the value of our civilization is measured by our arts and culture. And Senator Humphrey, on the floor, said, I wonder if we will invest in the value of our civilization the way we do, perhaps, in our uncivilization, namely war. This is 53 years ago, and here we are to have this discussion. So I am honored to have with us my friend and colleague, immediately to my right, Melody Barnes, chair of the Aspen Forum on Community Solutions, among many leadership roles, former domestic policy chair for the Obama White House in 2009 to 2012, as well as assistant to the president, and someone I worked closely with on arts education, specifically as a member of the President's Committee on Arts and Humanities. I'm so happy to have you with us,
Melody.
It's
great to be here.
I should also say that Melody and I do a mean ballroom dance. So we've left the center aisle free, so we'll see how that goes. And then it is our honor to have with us today, taking the time to come and have this discussion in the middle of so many things of dire importance for this country, Senior Senator from New Mexico, Tom Udall.
Thank you,
Tom. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you.
Tom has many intersections with the arts, which we're going to talk about, but I'm going to point out two, not in order of importance, as you'll hear why. The first is that, as of last week, he's the co-chair of the Senate Cultural Caucus, which is tremendously important, and we're grateful for your leadership.
Thank you.
And the second is he's married to Jill Udall.
Oh.
which is Jill, who served on the President's Committee for Arts and Humanities under President Obama and the First Lady, and is a champion of the arts in New Mexico and around the country.
And I correct you, that's the most important.
I did, I said, yeah, not
okay,
in order.
Okay,
so
okay,
the most
okay.
Important. That's
okay,
right.
Most
so
smart
let's lead this off, perhaps with each of you could make some comments on your own personal take on why the arts, you know.
Sure.
Senator, perhaps you'd start.
Sure,
no,
I'd love to start. The first thing that I, and you start with a why, Damian, and so it's a really interesting why to me. Why the arts? And this isn't the messaging part that Damian's talking about, but to me, the first thing is the arts bring joy and beauty to our lives, and there's no doubt about that. I mean, we all feel that. You see it in the visual arts, you see it in the performing arts. And the other side of the coin, which I find the fascinating one and the one politically sometimes having a hard time to deal with, is the arts make us address issues we don't want to address, that we don't want to face, that are controversial. Think Mapplethorpe, or think in New Mexico we had a art piece about the statue of Guadalupe, and all the Catholics in New Mexico got mad, and so that kind of thing. And then third, and this is the fascinating part of where we are right now, is the arts are a part of social change, sometimes very early on a part of revolution. Think of Saturday Night Live, you know, the creativity there. And then finally, just to close this and to jump into my experience and love of the arts and passion for the arts, is in this is a, it kind of comes from my father and the taming. He had the friend Robert Frost as a poet for his a good chunk of his life, and they used to always talk about poetry and power and the taming of the base instincts. And so that's kind of the, for me, the why of the arts. But I grew up in a family. My mother and father loved the arts. My mom actually had me from the age of about 10, Melody, practice piano for 8 or 10 years. I can't play a note now, but I mean, I think I learned something about music, and it stuck with me. She was my mother loved the Indian arts, and we were always in the Southwest, and so took an interest in the school. The Santa Fe Indian School, the IAIA at the beginning of it, those kinds of things. And then my dad, as I said, he had a kind of an intellectual, artistic side. He met Robert Frost when he was at the Poet Laureate, and Robert Frost was very grumpy and said, you know, I'm not going to... He says, I've been up here and I'm the poet for the Congress, but I've never met these congressmen. He says, they don't want to hear from me. So Dad had him over to dinner, and they developed this lifelong friendship. And one of the things I just wanted to read to you, this is because this is the big thing about the arts that I've believed all my life, is here's a letter from April 1961. You can see the yellowish paper and everything here, ancient. Dear Stuart. And he's talking to him from Robert Frost, and he says to him, you know, one of my missions is to get a Secretary of the Arts into the President's cabinet. But I am as good as in there with you to talk it up and do that. So anyway, that's the start of the discussion on the CREATE Act. But I really believe, just as Damian said, the arts explain our civilization, they amplify our civilization, and it's something that we're passionate about. And Jill and I, when it really gets intense and things are completely going to pieces, we sneak off to an art show or a museum or a movie or whatever it is to see creativity and relax a little bit. So wonderful. There you go.
Okay, so the underpinnings are very deep, obviously, and you know, referencing the great poet Robert Frost, has become, you know, part and parcel of advocating for the arts, you know, through President Kennedy's words about those uncomfortable truths that poets bring, and that opposition to arrogance, essentially, that the arts have. And I do think it's interesting you mentioned one thing that is very particular, is that sometimes we say arts, and then you mention Saturday Night Live, and you think, oh, Is that arts? Well, that's for profit, right? Does that mean it's not? What is that distinction? And we're going to hear later from Narek Rome, Americans for the Arts, about the arts and culture sector, which really is all of it, because it all is part and parcel of the same levels of creativity. It comes from the same place that ends up with your child's drawing on the refrigerator. It is that same thing. So thank you for those words. Now, Melody, aside from ballroom dancing, why the arts? I mean, your focus has been so strong on community building, and the work you did at the White House was all about investment into this country. And I know how passionate you are about so many aspects of this. Could you share?
Absolutely. I'd love to. As they say in Congress, I want to associate myself with the remarks of my friend, the senator.
Oh, that's good.
Because I think everything that you said is absolutely true. And like you, I grew up in a household where the arts were important. My name is Melody. My parents did not pull that out of a hat. It is for love of music and the arts. Wow. And grew up and cut my teeth on that. And we probably had the same piano lessons and had the same outcome. It's something that is very meaningful to me growing up. And I think that was one of the reasons why when I went into the West Wing, and that was a place where so many people did not necessarily see the arts. You know, the arts were an East Wing issue, and mm-hmm. certainly great work has been done from the East Wing, but what we felt was that the East Wing and the West Wing could meet, and at the intersection, many powerful things could happen for the reasons that you describe. I mean, the arts do help us take on some of the most challenging issues in front of us. You know, I think about one of the good friends of the Aspen Institute, Anna Deavere Smith, and work that she's doing right now on the Cradle to Prison pipeline. And as she listens to communities and young people all over the country, not only does she help convey their experience, but as she performs, she then stops and has the community sit in dialogue on issues and decide what is it that they can do to address this issue. So it's not only the discussion and the thinking about or the presentation of a difficult issue, but it's also engaging and the arts being a tool for engagement in communities for important social change. As you alluded to, Damian, one of the things that we found to be so important in the work that we did in the Obama White House was around economic issues. I mean, we all know the horrible economic challenge that faced the country as we were walking in the door in 2009. And I think one of the brilliant things that Rocco Landisman, who was then the NEA chair, was doing, and something that Jane Chu continues to focus on, so the role that the arts play as an economic driver in communities that so desperately need to revitalize. And there are critical reports that have been done both by the NEA, an interesting one done by the Economic Development Quarterly in 2015 that studied mid-sized cities and the amount of money that would then leverage significant change in communities because of the role that the creative class was playing. And often artists are the tip of the spear going into parts of communities that are really underperforming, the places where, quite frankly, most people wouldn't go. And all of a sudden you see artists, and you see murals, and you see performance, and you see change, and you see what happens economically as a result of that. And I could go on, and later on I may share some stats, as policy wonks are wont to do, about that. But we saw that as being important, and an alignment of the arts and a big issue, the biggest issue that was facing the president at that moment: how do we use federal resources to leverage important economic change? And then there's the work that we did that I am so proud of and enamored of and happy to see continuing, which is the work around turnaround arts and turnaround schools, and the role that the arts play in education and the stickiness of the arts. I mean, they're the obvious reasons that so many people know about, that young people that come to school that enjoy the performing arts or the visual arts find school to be more interesting. But building on top of that, the data that we have that show that it can turn around math and science and reading scores and performance for young people in middle school and high school, and that's for children who are struggling, as well as those who may not be struggling. We, in every case, we see test scores going up, we see grade point averages going up, as well as the love for the arts and the love of being in school and the opportunity to engage. So there's so many reasons that the arts are important in the lives of our communities and our young people.
So I want to pull out three strands from what you both said before I ask Tom to really bear down on something very specific, which is tremendously exciting, actually, in terms of a possibility of policy. And the three things I wanted to make sure were clear were the difficulty of the arts. You both mentioned piano and how you couldn't sit down at a piano and play, but you're giving testimony to the difficulty of the arts, which flies in the convention of the nicety of the arts. It's not simply that it's a nice thing to do. You worked. It's hard work. And one thing we learn in Turnaround Arts over and over again is that it is that level of work in first, second, third, fourth, fifth grade that the arts provide that creates the value. It is not simply that it is an enriching thing. It is something that is hard work of a very specific kind, which contributes to creativity and bears dividends throughout a lifetime. Mm-hmm. So that's the first thing I wanted to say. The other thing is you both referenced the idea of investment. And there's two types of investment that we're talking about here. One's investment as in individuals and in understanding. The challenges that Anna Deavere Smith puts before us in her presentation of the words of people in the, literally in the maelstrom of the school to prison pipeline, which we understand so much more through her art than we possibly could simply by reading it on the page in a factual way. It brings it to life in a different way. And the work in art and social justice today is in fact leading the edge of understanding. Titus Kaphar's beautiful work depicting the tragedy of the traffic stop of Sandra Bland. If you haven't seen that, I encourage you to see it. You can see understanding develop as you watch it develop in the works of art. And then there's the investment economically, which bears the fruit of the metrics of society, which, Melody, your work shows how it develops from here to here to here to here. And that makes one thing clear, that it's good policy. So going back to that idea of it's difficult, it's developing understanding, and it's developing our country, and it's good policy, actually. It doesn't make sense to go in another direction because it's good policy. So with that said, Senator Udall, the CREATE Act, tell us.
Okay, well, let me just back at you. I associate myself with both of your words, very good words. First of all, we looked at New Mexico as a senator and as a House member, and we started thinking, how should we think about the arts? And this, Damian, goes in a way to your messaging. And one of the things we realized, and Jill was the head of the arts agency in New Mexico, it's called the Officer of Cultural Affairs, and all the years, it took them till very recently that they really started looking at the economic impact and actually what was happening. And we discovered in New Mexico 1 in 10 jobs directly due to the arts and culture. And so we thought, well, if that's the case, what is it about the arts that isn't moving forward? And we realized the investing of capital, we realized that artists were really entrepreneurs that didn't have the ability to have support in the community. And so we came up with this piece of legislation called CREATE. And what CREATE really does is take every federal agency and say, you should be supporting the arts. And we encourage them, whether it was the SBA or the Economic Development Administration, think about the arts because the arts are also an economic driver. And that's where we started. And the three goals of CREATE are, first of all, to support the arts and as the arts and entrepreneurs as business folks, as and for what they do in the community. To give you one example there, when I talked about the ETA, the Economic Development Administration, in northern New Mexico, every year the eight northern Indian pueblos would get together and they'd bring in their rugs and their pottery and all of their arts and crafts and have a fair. But it was a very makeshift thing. And they'd put up a few tents and they'd fall down and it was a problem. And so the pitch was made to the EDA, make this more formalized. Can you come up with a little bit of investment of money to make a permanent facility? And the next thing you know, it blossomed and it was big. And that was an investment by the federal government from one of the agencies that does economic development. The second goal of the CREATE Act is to support art organizations and museums. And I'm just giving you examples here, but one example is we can use the tax code to very effectively support museums. And we've had some things happen in the past that weren't too great there, but clearly if the givers and collectors are given encouragement and incentives, the museums are going to do better, and then the museums being open to the public, everybody gets exposed to the arts. And then the third is support arts in the community. You all know the concept of young people working in the Peace Corps, or you know, anybody can go on the Peace Corps, or AmeriCorps here at the domestic level. What we propose in the CREATE Act is to have an artist corps that's out in the community, whether it's rural, urban, disadvantaged communities, and working with the community to grow the arts and to service for a short period of time in behalf of the arts. And so that's the basic idea. It's an acronym that has a very long name, and I have a wonderful creative staff, so I won't bother you with that. But the basic idea, I think, on the messaging, and I'm open for discussion and want to hear what you think the direction to move in, but I think if we focus on the economic activity that flows from the NEA and the NEH and flows from art activity, where you leverage, as we've learned in our communities, you can have a dollar spent and $8 pushed out in addition to that $1 that's invested, and so there's some really good leveraging. And so that's what the CREATE Act's about. We it's so big and it's so broad that everybody says, Mike, you know, this is a big goal and it's a dream and you'll never get it done. But just remember, the idea in the Senate, whenever we have a piece of legislation moving through, all of us participate in that. So say a tax bill moves through and we want the tax provisions done, we work with the head of the Finance Committee and we say, you know, in order for us to support this bill, we'd like to have these be a part of it, and we've built the support for it. So we'll probably do it piece by piece, but I urge you to look at the CREATE Act. I think do we have handouts here, Tanis and Jeff? No, we don't. Okay, but we'll give everybody sites to this and everything. Okay.
So I'm done. Before we go further, Senator, if you could just tell us in brief the path of this. I know it was introduced last year.
Yeah.
And now you're going to reintroduce it. Is that where we're at? Just so we know.
Yeah. And this gives us a way for you to engage in terms of caring about the arts. I mean, one of the things that we do as members of Congress, we think about these things, we engage with you, we put in a bill, but how do we get it done? And so we work with Narek and his organization. Everybody's going to hear from him in a little bit. And we will reintroduce it. And then they have an Arts Day on the Hill, and everyone that comes from all of the New Mexico, all the states from over the country will be asked to put a pitch in with their congressmen and with their senators to sign on to the bill as co-sponsors. Another way to build support. And as you all know, I mean, a bill doesn't get done the first time, so we're not discouraged at all. We're going to hang in there and keep fighting for it.
So, Senator, you mentioned Narek. So all of you saw that Bob Lynch was meant to be here, President of Americans for the Arts, but happily, for him, unhappily for us, he is accepting at this moment the John F. Kennedy Commonwealth Award in Massachusetts for his distinguished service. So we wish him well. But we have Narek Rome from Americans for the Arts. And I asked Narek if maybe you could put a little, even more, a little bit more meat on the bones of that advocacy for the CREATE Act that everybody should be aware of. Because part of what I think is that, you know, as we pointed out, there's a lot of divergent opinions on how to make a case. And I'm first one to say let's use a legalistic approach and go at it from all ways. But what do you think the main things people need to understand and know are in, as regards to this?
Thank you, Damian. Closer?
Yeah, why not?
Is that someone's phone?
Perfect.
The main thing, I think, associating myself with your remarks before, around the individual, and then you have the community as well, and the investment that accompanies that. The CREATE Act, which the acronym, I think, already shows the success of the bill, Comprehensive Resources for Entrepreneurs in the Arts to Transform the Economy, CREATE. And so that right there.
One more time.
Good.
I've said it enough, so I've committed it to memory, and it's wonderful. I mean, if you have a winning piece of legislation with a winning acronym like that, so the legislation, as the senator said, it captures all the federal support that in many places is already being extended in economic development ways, in small business administration, in microloans to individual entrepreneurs. These things are already happening. What isn't happening is that in many of these federal agencies, they're not aware that downstream, that the entrepreneur is in the arts and cultural field. And so the CREATE Act tries to increase the eligibility in some of the ways to explain that entrepreneurs in the arts are just like entrepreneurs in any other career path. And the technical assistance that goes out from our federal agencies can be increased to support what has been now measured as 4.2% of gross domestic product by the Bureau of Economic Analysis. And that same agency identifies the arts and cultural production account as being larger than transportation sector, larger than the construction sector, larger than the mining sector, and travel as well. Those are major industries, and only then underscores the size of the arts and cultural sector as an economic force and as a workforce. And so the Bureau of Economic Analysis study that comes out each year has continued to demonstrate the strength of a $730 billion industry. And that study is made possible by the National Endowment for the Arts pursuing that kind of research and data from its federal partners. Without the NEA's leadership asking for and also helping to fund that research, that's why we've ended up with a BEA satellite account that helps to underpin what the senator's legislation seeks to support through the other federal agencies.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Narek. I want to just imitate a few faces around the room, which went like this when you said that about the stats. People just literally were eyes. And this is Melody and I on the phone a little while ago.
Yeah.
And it goes back to that idea that the arts and culture sector is not just the symphony and the ballet and the Shakespeare Theater. It is the entire arts and culture sector. But it is one. It is a field. These are part of the same thing. So with that in mind, Melody, what are your reactions now? I mean, we had this conversation over years, but this is a very specific opportunity, it seems to me.
Right. Well, I find this so exciting, both as someone who's studied policy, but also on a very personal level, someone living in a community that has a significant creative class. That's contributing to the economic life of that community. It was interesting. I was telling someone that I was coming here, you know, a week or two ago, and they talking about the role that the government plays in the arts. And they said, oh, there's something beyond the NEA. And I think people don't think about all the different ways that the federal government can put resources out there that can be leveraged on the state and local level and by the private sector that are quite significant. And I think I mentioned this personal experience with it. About 14 months ago, my husband and I moved from Washington, D.C. to Richmond, Virginia. And one of the things that drew us there, I grew up there, but I will also say, bad daughter, that it was my husband who suggested that we move there. Don't mention that to the family. But one of the things that attracted us to Richmond was this very vibrant arts and culture and creative movement that's taking place there. Fantastic world-class museums, a new Institute of Contemporary Art that I've been involved with that's being built right now, galleries, artisans, the number two, tied for number two, public and in the public and public private sphere art school in the country that's then shedding all of these great artisans that are doing work in Richmond, going from the brand center to agencies in Richmond. And I mention all of that because as I look at what the CREATE Act does, I can see every step of the way how a community like Richmond can be affected by it and how it can serve and to leverage economic growth. You know, I think about artisans that are leaving Virginia Commonwealth University, like those who designed our kitchen table, who could benefit from the microloans that you're talking about and the work of the SBA. I think about the fact that 2 weeks ago, my husband and I attended a fundraiser for 1708 Gallery, which is a nonprofit gallery started by artists for artists, and artists that were contributing their work. And you look on the back of the brochure when you go to these events, and you see contributed 100% of the value or contributed 80% mm-hmm. of the value. But because of the charitable contribution provision in your bill, it makes it easier for them to get the benefit of all of the value of all of their work when they are making these kinds of, mm-hmm. of contributions. I think about the fact that we now have a designated arts district in which small playhouses and galleries and museums sit. So all of the things that you're focusing on, including the arts corps that can contribute to the work that we were doing, and bringing artists into schools that so desperately need that kind of level of contribution, and artists that do such a fantastic job that can help not only raise GPAs, but engage children in activity that they aren't getting for all the reasons that we know. So I'm very excited about this. I see how it contributes to the community in which I'm living now, but I see as I travel the country how it can continue to contribute in those communities and be a spark in those mm-hmm. communities where these are just ideas that are nascent, but could bring both economic and educational, and as we've said, voice to some of the big challenges that people are facing.
I think that I associate myself now with your remarks as well as everyone else's. But
if only Congress worked like
want
this.
I want to return in a moment. I just want to get this out there to Turnaround Arts and some of the issues that we faced in implementing Turnaround Arts, which was an effort that goes on as we speak to bring the arts to some of the nation's most underperforming schools as a turnaround strategy, an intentional strategy to use the arts as a turnaround mechanism. But what I was thinking about as you were talking is there's so many audiences that need to be reached in different ways. And some of it we just don't see. As you said, you think of a National Endowment for the Arts, oh, that's government support of the arts. Oh, but wait, there's also the efforts that Rocco did with HUD, with Rocco mm-hmm. Landisman, and on and on and on. And when I think about turnaround, which we'll come back to, one of the things we realized very early on was that we needed to identify what success looked like. So we were looking at things like, you know, how the school did on test scores. But then we also started immediately looking for things like unrest in the school. How much detention rates went up and down? Mm-hmm. How many kids were staying after school for detention? What did injecting the arts into a school do for that? And then one of the things that I felt most moved by was how parents got involved. And what a difference that made on a base level, just to work that metric alone, to take the arts into a place and the parents going to their children's school in a different way, for a different purpose that was all positive and all in that. So Senator, I was thinking that, you know, you mentioned all the different constituents you have to, you know, you're dealing with, and I know you've done a series of town halls about this.
Right.
And I was wondering if you could, you know, maybe you could talk about my people, the artists, a little bit, you know, how they react to this, because we tend to be a little prickly at times. We say, well, we're not here just to be useful, but also we also kind of want to see, you know, how this whole ecosystem works. And I'm wondering if you have any impressions about your town halls.
Well, we did town halls over, I think, about 10 to 12 cities in New Mexico and notified and gathered everyone who had anything to do with the arts and said, we've got a proposal for you. It's a work in progress. We want your input. Damian's right. I mean, talk about prickly. Sometimes artists, I mean, we use the term entrepreneur. People say, I'm not an entrepreneur, I'm an artist, you know, but David rolls his eyes. But you'd get some interesting feedback, but for the most part, there was an incredible amount of energy around the idea of focusing on how do we grow the creative economy. I mean, really, we'd go into these communities where 10 years ago, they hadn't even thought of the arts. I mean, they were going downhill, they were rural, and they've started to recover. When Melody talked about arts bringing back communities, I thought of Detroit immediately. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you have the big city of Detroit collapsing, bankruptcy, the first hopeful sign was the artist community moving into downtown Detroit, and then after that, everything started to grow from there. And so that's the same impression I had traveling across New Mexico, is you were opening eyes and people down in Silver City. The artist folks had been interested in this all along, but as you broadened it out and brought the economic development people in, they said, you know, we can grow this. We need to do, and they'd start making lists of things that they wanted to do at the local level to grow their creative economy. So there's a huge amount of excitement, and a lot of it is being focused through Narek and Bob's organization, which we every year try to plug in with when they visit Washington. They sign a letter too. Get your member of Congress to sign a letter supporting the arts. And some of you may not know it. I mean, we're at about, what, $147 million for the NEA? Where do you think that was? When I got into Congress back in about 1994, it was $197 million, I believe. And so can you imagine how much we could leverage and push and grow if we were growing the arts budget every year and we had the kind of activity that the CREATE Act is pushing?
Yeah, I mean, you're speaking about that amplifier effect that every arts dollar goes to. You mentioned the figure 8 to 1, the things that go, that are the add-ons, the collaborative, frankly, the collaborative spirit that the arts are. I mean, that's what it does.
Right.
It does it. It's never just basic, okay, there it is. There's always more and more layers to be added. And Melody, let's talk now. We can go back to turnaround, but just curious of your thoughts of what success looks like on a community level then, you know, in terms of that. But also, anything about engagement strategies that, you know, we can actually use to move forward. And we should also think about the people in this room at some point towards the end of this and send them off with a task.
Right. Well, one of the things, and you and I were involved in this conversation, almost about a year ago, and you used so brilliantly the terminology citizen artist. And I think artists often, for many reasons, will go to the challenging places because they've got inexpensive space, because there's inspiration, for any number of reasons. But what I also love is that artists often go to the challenging places with great intentionality. And they go there because they realize that there is great work that they can do with the gifts and the tools and the skills that they have. That includes certainly the work that we saw with incredible artists, you and Yo-Yo and others, who have been going into schools and, you know, doing the artist strikes and all the work that you've been doing to engage with children on a very consistent basis, but bringing art skills and talent into schools that are so deeply challenged in every way, to support teachers so that we are bringing in arts programs for those students, and now have expanded to something like 68 schools in 15 states, now in partnership with the Kennedy Center. So we see that kind of intentionality. You know, I mentioned Anna DeVere Smith's work, but I know of other institutions that specifically say our purpose is to help our community and our region and the country take on some of the most difficult issues that we are facing right now. And how do we collaborate and how do we engage at a time of great friction in our country and answer some of the questions that are sitting in front of us? That kind of intentionality. I think about the role that artists are playing with Theaster and others in focusing on housing and how do you help those who are impoverished and struggling to find decent places to live to face that challenge. So I think that artists bring that. It isn't kind of sweetness and light, but it is great intentionality and thought with their work as to how we can take on some of the biggest challenges that are facing our country today. I think the artist core, and we've talked, Narek has talked about how we engage members of Congress to support your legislation, to support the NEA. All of those things are very important ways that those of us, and I'll speak for myself, who have less great artistic talent, and I've tried it all. I've taken acting lessons. I've tried water painting. they're the piano lessons. But how we can work alongside artists to support them in the way that your piece of legislation does, with the resources that support the NEA, that support programs like Our Town, which is giving grants to cities and towns of all sizes that focus on the arts, so continuing to leverage those federal dollars, the things that we can do, and to articulate the importance of the arts because of beauty, because it helps us take on those big issues, as well as the economic and educational reasons that we've discussed.
So, you know, you mentioned the NEA, and I'll call it out the NEH as well, National Endowment for the Humanities.
Yes.
And I'm sure many of you read that there is an intention, perhaps in the new administration, to dispense with funding both of those institutions, which are now 50 years old and have done countless amounts of good work. But when we think about that, obviously in advocacy, it's not a political question; it's actually a belief question. Going back to the beginning, do we believe that these organizations are actually a part of what we are as a country, in a way that is progressive for us as a society, and how do we support that? And I was thinking about the varying ways that the National Endowment for the Arts particularly explains itself, and if you read their materials and if you work with them and you look at it, that they support organizations of many sizes, but predominantly small and mid-sized organizations. They also support large organizations as essential forms to purvey the arts in the country, but they are dealing on every level, but especially trying to gain access for the arts for all Americans, for all people in this country. They support 50 states, it's all very clear, it's all there. But I was thinking about those organizations, and we've talked a little bit about individual artists, but we haven't talked so much about arts organizations and where they sit. I was a member of the New York City Ballet, one of this country's great arts organizations, for almost 25 years. In one of the great efforts of the arts in America at Lincoln Center, which grew out of community development, essentially. That was, Lincoln Center sits where West Side Story was filmed, and now it occupies a central place in our nation's cultural economy and in our nation's economy, essentially. I mean, it is a force to be reckoned with in every way, from artistic to economics. And we think about those organizations and what is their role in society as they are public goods. And I think about that as being another aspect that we have to look at and look at how people react. And in this time when we're trying to understand how to advocate for arts and government having a parallel destiny, how do we do that? So I wanted to call out a few things that I've noticed in this current time, which speak to the role of the arts, to what Senator Udall, you were saying about perhaps making uncomfortable truths, perhaps making statements as you mentioned, about Anna's work, which is consistently over so many years has done just that. And MoMA, Museum of Modern Art, for instance, maybe you read last week, reorganized its fifth floor to include countries from the travel ban. They took down Matisse and they brought in a work of art by an Iranian artist. They intentionally did some things in the name of openness and freedom of the arts as a thing. And I think that, you know, and the Public Theater is another one that does incredible work in terms of being openness. But I think that, and I'm citing New York because that's where I live, but it's all around the country. But I wanted to talk about space. When we think about organizations, they tend to have space. And how they use it really matters. And there's been, in my time, a cultural shift from where the arts organization was a little bit of a place where you went to see art, in many cases, to a place where you go to be. And if you have that kind of space, and I'm wondering, Senator, if you see that in New Mexico in the same way, that, you know, that it may be a theater complex, a theater company, but it's also a place where people go to be creative, to do work. Right. They have the Wi-Fi, they have the cafe, and it's a place of creativity. Yeah. How do you see that developing in your state and around the country?
Yeah, I think that's something that is particularly important. You've described it so well. I'm not sure I can even build on it much further. But the thing I want to go back to, NEA and NEH. I mean, we're fighting every year, and it's true what Damian has said. I mean, there is a plan from a think tank for zero funding. And so I would like to have one of my messages be is, you know, this is a call to action to make sure that the arts through the NEA and NEH are still a part of our society and still very much viable, strong organizations. And I think this goes to somewhat, Damian, what you're talking about. When I think of the situations, if you urge an agency like the Veterans Administration, and they team up with the NEA, which is what Rocco Landisman did on the Healing Arts Program. And here you have veterans returning from war, you know, psychically having big difficulties, wounded many times. I saw a guy just the other day that had one arm and both legs gone. And he was up, optimistic and strong. And so the arts bring something to the table there that's very special in terms of healing after somebody's been through something really horrendous like that. And then I think of the NEA in terms of the moving the space in a way, Damian. We have a great symphony. Please come and visit us in Santa Fe. Symphony, chamber music, desert chorale. I mean, we have all this huge arts activity. But the NEA, we don't just do it there in town. They force these organizations in a way and leverage these organizations, take it out into the rural areas, go to the military bases, you know, expose children to arts that have never seen the arts. And so that's something pretty special, I think, that we need to retain. And as I said earlier, it does the best leverage in terms of the dollar. You put in a dollar and it pulls in another $8. And that creates a new space too.
That speaks a little bit to the idea of citizen artists that you mentioned, which is a kind of a concept that is as old as art itself, but it's a nomenclature that speaks to that idea that artists function as citizens of their small, bigger, biggest community of the world. About how they actually interact can be terribly intentional. It doesn't have to be, but there is I would call it a movement that is taking place where it's not simply about what's being done on the stage, but it's also what is the creative atmosphere and what are those rings that build around an arts organization or around an individual artist. Someone like Yo-Yo, for instance, is a walking citizen artist. He is right now somewhere shaking hands with somebody as he walks in and making them understand what it means to be in a creative presence and inspiring and teaching, as well as being the cellist in chief. And so, Melody, let's talk a little bit about that idea, that role that the arts play in your mind in that community development, or you know, any of those things about organizations. I know you're so involved in the museum in Richmond. We've talked a lot about that. I mean, you just dove right in for a reason.
Yeah.
And everybody has a role to play, as you said.
Absolutely. You know, yeah. And I want to talk a little bit about that, because I feel like it touches on so many of the things you were talking about. Space, the taking on of difficult issues. Mm-hmm. So just by way of a little bit of background, lots of people, when I say, oh, have you ever been to Richmond, they say, oh, we've driven through it. But people know the history, you know, and people, the first thing that usually rolls trippingly off the tongue was capital of the Confederacy. And Richmond, I was born there in the mid-60s. By the early 70s, the bottom was just falling out of the city. A lot of it, I think, was a reaction to desegregation and flight, and people were just leaving the downtown. And as a result, between the early 70s and well into through the 80s and early 90s, the downtown was a ghost town. No one shopped there, no one really lived there, the communities that surrounded it were failing, high crime rates, drug trafficking, just a very difficult place. Virginia Commonwealth University saw an opportunity, started to buy up a lot of the land surrounding the school in the heart of the downtown. And that started to clean things up, grow the school, bring a vibrant student population down, now 30,000 students. And you fast forward to today and what will happen in October, which will be the opening of the Institute of Contemporary Art, sitting at one of the major thoroughfares in Richmond at the heart of Belvedere and Broad. I mentioned that to you for a couple of reasons. One, there's a world-class architect and a world-class building that's going up there that literally, when I'm in a taxi, when I'm in Lyft, when I'm in Uber, whatever, you know, drivers are always like, everyone comments on the building. People are proud to see this building, a city that was that had so many different kinds of monuments, now see this as an iconic building that they can be proud of. The space literally faces both the university and faces Jackson Ward, which historically was known as the Harlem of the South. It was a vibrant African-American community. The highway was put in and ran right through that community, cutting part of it off from the rest of the city. The redlining that took place meant that those like Maggie Walker, who was one of the first African-American millionaires, people who lived there could not get loans to buy houses. So a lot of discrimination took place in this vibrant community. But very intentionally, the museum, the institute, now faces that community as it faces the university. The spaces that are being built there are spaces, as you alluded to, that are places where people can literally just come and sit. It is LEED certified gold. There are green roofs. There will be outdoor sculptures. Things that also just say, come and be here. Students, community that was cut off in the past, come be here. And at the same time, the opening exhibit, it's a non-collecting institute, the opening exhibit is called Declaration. And very intentionally bringing in artists from all over the world to speak to and to confront the issues that are not just taking place in Richmond for the reasons that I mentioned and that we are moving through, and not just taking place in the United States, issues that we are struggling with and moving through, but also issues that confront us globally, showing that we are all connected, even as we all struggle with these issues that are affecting us in our local communities. And doing that in a very bold way. Ways that allow artists to stake their declaration, ways to connect back to the Declaration, our capital, designed by Thomas Jefferson, but also a declaration of where we go and who we are as a people. So I think in all the ways you describe, the literal physical space and the challenge, taking on these challenging issues, and a place where people can come and be and sit and feel connected in ways that they may not have felt connected to other institutions before, are very, very important, and ways that arts organizations as well as individual artists play a role in helping to shape our communities and making sure that they thrive.
Would I be right in saying that there's no chance this would have happened without intersections with government?
You know, absolutely. I mean, you think about the resources from the school, even as we raise additional funds to build the institute and to endow it. It's connected to a public university, mm-hmm. And the relationship that the mayor has, the pride of the governor, they're all the different arms and legs. The private sector, the public sector, the philanthropic sector are helping to leverage this, and our goal is to ensure that the community is closely connected to this institution as well.
I think that, you know, we've visualized now on a state level and now on a city level something that, you know, I consider essential. I mean, you've described an essential piece that in 2 or 3 years would be unthinkable not to be there,
right?
Because it'll be so embedded into the community, and that is the value that fuels that belief that we started with. Okay, so we have about just under 15 minutes left, and we have a lot of people here, so we'll try and take a couple of questions.
Sure.
If you guys are up for that. We have mics around, so if you could keep it a brief question, we'll try and do it quickly, and we'll start right here. If you could identify yourself, say hello.
My name is Todd Wiggins. I wanted to thank you, Ms. Barnes, by the way. Some years ago, you introduced Senator Clinton at the Center for American Progress,
yes.
And I was in a position to ask her a question about Walter Reed. And I have that clip from YouTube, so I just want to thank you.
Thank you.
Just sort of a shout out. But I wanted to ask, perhaps this will go to both of you, what are you in competition with? Because whenever you're looking for resources, there's always another opportunity for someone else to allocate resources for that same thing that you're looking for. So what are you in competition with? Is it military? Is it infrastructure projects? Is it other economic projects, et cetera?
Yeah, well, at the federal level, I'll talk about the competition in terms of my role on the Appropriations Committee and looking at the competing interests that come in to try to make arguments. And we've been in, first of all, just as you should understand, as an overall thing, we've been in a sequester now, a 10-year sequester that was put into law, which specifically was thought it was just going to be the hammer over our head to create a good budget. And we put all these things in there and we thought, oh, you know, this is going to make us come together as a party. And it ended up that one side said, no, we like the sequester, and so we've been in the sequester. And so what ends up happening is we have a cap on the defense side and a cap on the domestic side. And the reason we haven't seen the growth I talked about in moving up NEA and NEH funds is that everything's capped. And so and as you know, in this world, I mean, as we grow, there's more needs. As we move forward and new opportunities open up, everybody wants to invest and push and get the government to go here and there. And so we've been in very, very difficult times. And part of that has been a national conflict where we haven't made a strong decision as to the role that government plays, the good role that government plays, as Lincoln used to talk about, the government doing things for people that they can't do for themselves. And we need to, I think, continue to invest like that. But so what ends up happening, you talk about the competition, everybody's fighting over those government dollars. And then when you get out to the NEA and NEH spending money, then they end up taking dollars that are out there. You know, there are a lot of people in this country that love the arts, and when they see the government weighing in, they say, "Oh well, I'm gonna help that along a little bit. I'm gonna move that along." A good example, we have it's profit making, and Damian's kind of put the blessing on it's okay to profit make here, so I'll do it too. There's a really young group of artists that started a thing called Meow Wolf, and it's in Santa Fe. It's opened up. Nobody thought it was going to go anywhere, and it's this really creative, like otherworldly kind of experience where you walk in and you're in a house where the people are gone, but you can explore everything about their lives. You can look at their diaries. You can go to the bathroom and see what kind of toothpaste they have. And, you know, all these things just start happening. And people get these crazy ideas and dreams, and, you know, they want to spend a long time there. And so this Meow Wealth project, nobody says it's not going to make it. It's not going to do. And people in the community, talking about Comedian for Resources, we have some really committed entrepreneurs, and they looked at this Meow Wolf thing and said, boy, I'm going to put 10 grand in that. I'm going to put 20. And the next thing you know, they're now exporting this Meow Wolf model to other cities in the Southwest. They've got a project to go up to Denver. They've got another project, I think, out in the Midwest. And so there's no limit in a way. That's the wonderful thing I like. And when Damian talked about places to be, that's what they've created very much. When you talk about go to a place to be, they have a children's playroom that is, you first walk into it and you think, I mean, looking at it from a non-professional, these kids are going to get hurt because there are all these things where they can pick up and throw and do, but they, and they only have one person in the room with 200 kids at some point when it kind of reaches its level. But they say it works out just fine, and they haven't had anybody injured. And so the kids, and it's totally free, rather than, you know, it's profit making, but they've created a room where any kid in Santa Fe can come and spend time. Parents drop them off. There's one adult supervisor in the room. And so it's this thing, there are limits, but it's also very expansive.
So we're going to go to one more question, maybe.
I'm sorry right there, to go on so long on that Melody, one. I'm Melody.
I want to just do a quick follow-up with you on this, because in a sense, you kind of did the rubber meets the road question. Yeah. You know, in the end, you're going to have to, somebody's not going to get what they want when you get what you want.
Yes.
And in the jockeying for position that went on in your life as domestic policy chair, and to, you know, and I know your passion was such that you were looking for ways that the arts could be, of, first of all, looking for actual value, which, you know, drove the data, you know, that we did with that report and reinvesting in arts education. We got the data first to make sure that we weren't messing around here before we could sit and actually have the real discussion. But that opportunity cost issue, that's real, huh? I mean, any thoughts to...
Oh, yeah, no, absolutely. And I think, I mean, you put your finger on exactly the thinking, and I believe Rocco, Rachel Goslins, who was leading the President's Committee with you all at that time, thought, okay, we're living in a resource-constrained world.
Highly resource-constrained.
We are often the first target that people come after because of this perception of the arts as something nice as opposed to necessary. So how do we thread that needle? And it was looking for ways that the arts and artists could play a role in leveraging what had to happen, set of policy transformations. So how do we work on community development and economic recovery, said the NEA? How do we align ourselves with one of the president's top goals at that time, which was turning around low-performing schools? So by doing that, it was very smart. It took a lot of the political heat away. I think Rocco had some great opportunities to testify before Congress, as opposed to taking, you know, the arrows and the attacks, because he thought was very thoughtful about our town and some of the other initiatives, because of the work that you all did, which was seen as quite necessary and helpful and part of a larger universe, what was happening with regard to school reform.
So what happened is you described a runway appearing, in a sense. Within the overall thrust of policy, the runway appeared, and that's where we were able
and
to
land the plane. Look for ways. And once you can get in and you can build more allies, as you are doing so wonderfully with the legislation, then you can start to look for other opportunities. But you can't ignore political reality. I mean, end of the day, you're counting votes.
Yeah, that's right. Question.
Hi there. My name is Nafisa, and I'm with the Smithsonian APA Center, and we're like the Meow Wolf of the Smithsonian, basically. I love Meow Wolf. Went to Santa Fe last year and was blown away by the work that they do, as well as the work of the National Dance Institute of New Mexico, and all these great organizations that are working with the community there. And a lot of the, well, thank you, first of all, for sharing all your insights and strategies. Many of the things you mentioned today we already do at the APA Center, and as such, we're seen as kind of like a renegade center at the Smithsonian because we're a fairly young team. But we prioritize arts and activism, investing in the artists that we work with, doing community and collaborative curation with our artists, not just kind of like the top-down curatorial work that usually happens at institutions like ours. And so the main question that I have is, given the challenges that we have in implementing these larger you know, broader policy changes, especially with the current administration and potential loss of funding, how can we ask institutions like the Smithsonian, like large universities and other institutions that are funded privately, to leverage their influence to be less risk averse, with the content, in terms of the people that they work with, in terms of paying artists a fair wage, diversifying the artists that they work with, and really connecting in more grassroots ways with local communities around the country.
Yeah, I think you've said it very well, and I support that totally. I wouldn't say much more. Go on to the next question, unless Melody or Damian wants to jump in.
I would just say that, you know, I think meaningful incentives go a long way in that regard. I was lucky enough to be a part of an effort with the Jerome Robbins Foundation beginning in 2009-10 to incentivize new works for dance companies around the country in the belief that in a risk-averse environment, financially, perhaps they wouldn't get made. So seed money was provided as matching grants, and we got to get a lot of new works made. So I think that's a meaningful strategy with institutions large and small, is to pursue those kind of incentive strategies on a government level. Yeah. We have time for one more. I have to come over to this side of the room. Sarah, you go over here. Quick question. In fact, why don't we do... We're going to do three quick questions, and then we'll do that.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Joanna Brignolo. Tell me how you're going to remove the constraints of government funding for artists, if they're controversial in what they, much like futurism. I went reading about futurism glorifying war. So would we accept someone, if we had a third futurism movement today, would we be accepting that if we were going to be funding it? And the other just quick question is, if NEA and NEH survive, will your artist corps be subsumed underneath them? Will they be the overseers for? Because there has to be some umbrella organization.
Yeah. Okay, so we had a question about the funding of individual artists, which is actually, okay, and then the second one about the structure of artist corps. Please.
I have a question. I'd like to go back to the senator's original letter from Robert Frost of April 1961. From a long-term strategy, isn't it better to try to aim for something like a Department of Art and Culture? Because I spent a lot of time in Europe and in Japan, and there are a lot of countries around the world that have ministries of culture and art. And I'm thinking all the discussion today has been about domestic, which is fine, but if you think about the globalization of art, it is so important for the United States to be able to engage globally. In order to do that, it would be much more effective to have a central organization, whether it's a cabinet office or an agency, that can coordinate, not only domestically, but internationally, globally. So I think I realize the constraints right now, but over the next 15, 20, 30 years, isn't it a strategy to try to create that kind of an organization that really is focused specifically on government support of the arts?
Okay, last question. Go to the back. Sarah, you choose.
Thanks, are you first? Okay. Hi, thanks for all this conversation. It's been good, but I kind of feel like we've been preaching to the converted. And so my question is, if the cultural agencies are threatened in the current administration or in other administrations, what are the actions that citizen artists can perform to help save these vital institutions?
Okay, that's a great one to end on. So we'll get to that very quickly. I know we're going to lose the senator very quickly, so we're going to go fast. And I would just say that let's finish with hers as far as actions, because as much as we started as a choir, I actually think we all have different ideas of how we can be effective, which was what this is about, information for everybody.
Yeah. Well, let me finish in the broadest possible context, and Melody, I go back to your your boss, President Obama. Mm-hmm. I thought his farewell address really, in a way, kind of set up the new administration coming in. And he had given a lot of thought to it. And he didn't talk about, you know, you electing good leaders and, you know, the leaders are going to go out and do this and that. He said the biggest check on a president or on an administration is an engaged citizenry. And that's really, you know, where we are today. We need to be engaged at every level. If it's the arts, the NEA, NEH, I mean, be engaged, be there, stand for them. And I think a lot, you'll see if this attack comes, I think you'll see a lot of the artists join in terms of their view of what really happens. And a lot of times when you're under attack, you perform the best. And so I think we're going to see that from the arts community. The idea on Artist Corps is to grow more of the arts, is to have it really be something that is the reservoir of what we want. So mm-hmm. back to Melody. You and Melody.
Sure. One, I agree with you. I think organizing, mm-hmm. as we organize on a local and state level, and with our eye on what's happening on the federal level, that members of Congress, you can speak to this better than I, pay attention to email, phone ringing, people at their door, and what they want. When they think either their constituents want something different or they don't care, then they may vote to try and eliminate those cultural institutions. But we've seen the pushback. I mean, we saw when Reagan was considering getting rid of the NEA, you know, both data and evidence and people pushing back using that data and evidence led to the NEA continuing and ultimately its budget increasing until it hit a particular plateau. So I think it is incumbent upon us to organize, and we see a lot of good organizing that's taking place on the local level, and certainly young people who are actively interested and engaged. And I think it's a matter of getting the best information, I'm a data and evidence geek in the same way that I am an artist geek. So I think putting those two things together is critical. With regard to the Department of Arts and Culture, and certainly I've heard this in the past, you know, you're right. Right now it is certainly very hard to imagine. I think as a government structure, I mean, we have to ask ourselves if we want to, and what the costs are and what the benefits are of creating a new institution and all that means. I mean, think about the Department of Homeland Security and how long it takes to get that right and what that means in terms of resources. And does that meet what our ultimate goal is? Because what I hear you saying is that we need a coordination function, which I absolutely agree with. Does that require a new institution, or does that require better empowering and bringing together both the domestic and the international work on the arts and with the arts community to better coordinate that in a central place in the executive branch? I mean, the State Department already does quite a bit on the international side. You know, I had the domestic side, and certainly we would often talk to one another, but what's the best way of doing that? And I think oftentimes people, and I completely understand, see a new institution as a sign that something is important. But the question is, how do we best use our resources to try and accomplish our goal? And that's where I think we should put our ultimate focus.
Yeah, and Melody, the interesting thing, and I think the arts, the people that debate this on, do you have a one minister of the arts or secretary of the arts, the NEA and NEH directors have told me it's made them more entrepreneurial. Mm. I mean, I don't know mm-hmm. that you would get a healing arts program where they would go out over to the VA and say, put a little money in, or go over to HHS and say, put some money in here. So that model we have now may need some coordination, but it's been working really well, mm-hmm. especially when you have these entrepreneurial folks like Rocco Landisman out there moving around and trying to push things.
I would just underline your words about engagement in answer to that larger question. And I think it's on every level that we've discussed, and I think we've discussed lots of different levels. But on that individual level, it's not only advocating or understanding the data that NARIC, for instance, gave us and the other things, but it's also participating in a way that shows intention. I think that it also, you know, I was going to finish, actually. It came to me that we're approaching the 100th anniversary of the birth of Leonard Bernstein. And he testified in front of Congress. He talked about the supply and demand of the arts, that the more people know, the better the arts have to be, that the supply will get better if the demand is there to raise the bar on the arts. So individuals' participation creates better art. I once heard, I had the privilege of sitting with Jasper Johns and a young artist who was talking about their art and said something to the effect of, I wish it was a little more like this, and he said, make better art. Yes. Was his answer. And we all need to make better art in our own ways. That is what engagement is. It's going to the places, it's the institutions making a radical welcome, and then it's being welcomed and participating. And I think there's huge opportunities for that on every level, as we talked about, on the city level, on the state level, and as a country, for our own enlightenment and for our own progress. I want to thank you, Senator. Melody, thank you so much.
Thank you all of you. Real pleasure. It was great being with you.